Little Brown Audio presents Cut Short, written by M.W. Craven and read by John Banks. The Killing Field. Animals don't die of old age. Well, some do, of course. The occasional Galapagos tortoise might make it all the way to the end, or one of those ageless jellyfish. Maybe a beloved pet. But that's not many. Not when you consider how many animals aren't tortoises or jellyfish or beloved pets. For most animals, old age is a terrifying, hungry existence. Predators starve to death. Prey animals get eaten. Beef cows get slaughtered. Dairy cattle stop producing milk and become a financial burden. Elderly, incontinent pets become an inconvenience. But sometimes, just sometimes, something far worse comes along. More brutal than old age. Indiscriminate, unforgiving, devastating. And in a roundabout way, it occasionally kills humans. Detective Sergeant Washington Poe wasn't thinking about a terrifying and hungry existence that morning. He was thinking what a nice day it was. He and his friend and colleague, Tilly Bradshaw, were breakfasting outside, and he was thinking he might have another piece of toast before they drove to the Sellafield Visitors' Centre. He hadn't wanted to go to the Sellafield Visitors' Centre. He told Bradshaw that he'd rather set his teeth on fire than go to the Sellafield Visitors' Centre. But she'd insisted. Said he should see it before it was demolished. She'd been three times, and she lived in Hampshire, she'd told him. He hadn't been once, and he only lived half an hour away. Poe had told her that was everything she needed to know about his interest in nuclear fuel. In the end, he'd compromised. That is to say, he gave in. As he always did. In truth, he didn't mind. They had a whole week off, and he enjoyed her company. And there was a lovely pub nearby. It did steak and kidney pudding with buttered mash, real gravy. If they didn't hang around in the science place, which was what he called it, they could get to the pub before it stopped serving lunch.
"It'll be great, Poe," she'd said. "They have these interactive games where you can dress up as an isotope."
He'd looked at her. "Don't make me change my mind," he'd said. Before they could leave, Poe had to navigate his way through their ongoing discussion about his diet. This one was about wholemeal bread, specifically Poe's refusal to eat it. "Life's too short to not eat white bread, Tilly," he said, as he reached for the last piece of toast. He slathered it with salted butter and took a bite.
"You keep saying that, Poe," she said, "but all you're doing is stacking up problems for tomorrow."
He held it up. "It's one bit of toast."
"That is one bit of toast, Poe, but so were the other seven bits you've eaten."
"I thought you'd be pleased," he said. "You're always saying I eat too much meat."
"You do eat too much meat, but eight pieces of toast is too much toast."
He sighed, tried to throw it back on his plate, but only succeeded in dropping it on the ground. Luckily, Edgar, his English Springer Spaniel, was off chasing curlews somewhere, so Poe was able to safely retrieve it. Grabbing food off the floor was the quickest way to get bitten on the hand. "Typical," he grunted. It had landed butter side down and was now covered in dry grass and dust. Probably sheep shit. Poe was a keen proponent of the 5-second rule, but he had limits. He put it on his plate in disappointment. Now all he'd be able to think about was toast. He picked it back up, considered scraping off the worst of the muck.
"What is typical, Poe?"
"Huh?"
"You said something was typical."
"My toast. It always lands on the buttered side when I drop it. It's typical of my bad luck, I suppose." She gave him a look, one he recognized well.
"It's maths, Poe, not luck," she said, without a trace of irony. "Toast usually falls from the table and is almost always butter side up when it does. Unless there are outside factors involved, the spin rate is rarely fast enough for it to go through a full revolution before it reaches the ground. If tables were 10 feet high, we would say that toast always seems to land butter side up."
Poe said nothing.
"Actually, I wouldn't say toast always seems to land butter side up, but people who don't understand fundamental physical constants would. I can show you the maths if you want."
"I'd rather dress up as an isotope." She didn't respond. "What is it?" he said.
"Someone's coming."
Poe didn't get casual visitors. His isolated former shepherd's croft was on the wind-ravaged, sheep-heavy Shap Fell.
It was 2 miles from the nearest road and could only be accessed on foot or by all-terrain quad bike. Even with directions, most people couldn't find it. But Bradshaw was right. There was someone coming. A man. They watched him approach. He was obviously a cop. The short hair and no-nonsense machine-washable suit were dead giveaways. Poe hoped his week off was about to get a day shorter.
"Hello," Bradshaw said.
"Hi," the man said. "I'm sorry, have I interrupted your breakfast?"
"No, I just like holding toast," Poe said.
"Who are you and what do you want?"
"I'm Detective Constable Mike Penhaligon. I've been asked to come and get you."
"Why?" "We have a situation."
"What situation?"
"I've been told your first impressions are particularly intuitive. So I've been instructed to say nothing more than we've found 2 bodies.
"I don't work for Cumbria Police anymore. Tilly and I work for the National Crime Agency's Serious Crime Analysis Section."
"We know, Sergeant Poe, but Detective Superintendent Nightingale's the senior investigating officer, and she asked for you personally." Which was odd. Nightingale was a great cop, a great SIO, and had a solid team around her.
"Why?" Poe said.
"Jo knows what she's doing.
The circumstances are unusual. She thought you might be able to add value."
"Let's go," Poe said.
Penhaligon drove. Up to Carlisle, then left. It was a warm day. Poe and Bradshaw both had their windows down. The air began to smell unpleasantly sweet. Penhaligon turned towards Great Orton Airfield, and Poe put 2 and 2 together. He put his window up, told Bradshaw she might want to do the same.
"We heading to where I think we are," he said to Penhaligon.
"We are. What's happened?"
"It might be best if you saw it for yourself."
The 2001 foot and mouth outbreak ripped the heart out of Cumbria. It was the most serious animal epidemic in modern times, and it turned the usually peaceful county into a place of turmoil, carnage, and despair. More than a quarter of Cumbria's livestock, the majority disease-free, were culled. Accumulated breeding programs of earlier generations wiped out by the slaughterman's bolt gun. Legacies snuffed out. Poe remembered the thousands of chemical footpaths, the keep out, animals under observation signs, the do not leave the road signs, the closed signs on parks, woods, even children's playgrounds. He remembered how eerie the sheep-free fells had been, the empty pubs and towns. Foot and mouth had decimated the tourist industry. When the lakes and fells were out of bounds, Cumbria had little else to offer. With over 2 miles of mass graves, the long-abandoned RAF airfield at Great Orton was Cumbria's foot-and-mouth graveyard. Known locally as the Killing Field, it is the largest mass burial site in the world. 500,000 carcasses are buried there in 26 pits. Diseased animals killed on their farms had been transported there in leak-proof containers on articulated lorries. Healthy animals had been taken there alive, lined up and killed by Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries and Food slaughtermen. Tipped into pits, 20 at a time. The animals are still there now. Rotting. Decomposing. Leaking. Penhaligon parked at the rear of a long row of vehicles, mostly police, but there were Environment Agency vans there as well. Poe could see shapeless people in baggy white biohazard suits working inside a cordon hastily constructed around a recently opened pit. Some of them were inside, others milled around the edges. He couldn't tell if they were Environment Agency or CSI. Probably both, he thought. A bunch of cops were hanging around the outer cordon, all of them wearing face masks. "The boss is waiting down there for you, Sergeant Poe," Penhaligon said. He handed them a face mask each. "You'll want to wear these. They won't entirely stop the smell, but at least nothing floaty will get into your mouth."
"I'd like 6, please," Bradshaw said.
Poe approached the group of cops outside the cordon, the rank, gamey stench getting stronger with each step. By the time he reached the cordon, the heavy, cloying smell of decaying tissue, the liquid slime of bodies breaking down, was leaching through the face mask's permeable barrier. He remembered a previous case, one that had involved men being burnt alive in Cumbria's myriad stone circles. One of the detectives involved in the case had described the smell as miasmatic. Poe had needed to look it up. It meant noxious vapors from decomposing organic matter.
a word of the day, if ever there was one. The smell got into his throat, and he gagged.
"Did you know that the nose is the only organ that can see into the past, Poe?" Bradshaw said. "Smell is retrospective. It's already happened."
Poe appreciated her attempt at distraction. He thought it was probably as much for her as it was for him. And it might have worked if he hadn't started to hear buzzing. He stared into the pit. The carcasses appeared to be moving. He knew it was an illusion. It was flies, millions of fat bluebottles feasting on their rancid bounty, laying their eggs. In a few days, the pit would be crawling with maggots.
"You can stay in the car if you want, Tilly."
She shook her head and set her face. Looked determined. She was in this for the long haul. A tall woman broke away from the group. She had short dark hair and the greenest eyes Poe had ever seen. She was called Jo Nightingale, and they'd worked cases together before. She was one of the few police officers he respected.
"It's been a while, Poe," she said. "Hi, Tilly." "Hello, Detective Superintendent Nightingale."
"Still trying to get Poe to stop eating like a teenager?"
"What's happened, ma'am?" Poe said, eager to avoid another discussion about white bread.
She pointed at the pit.
"This is Pit 14. The soil in its interceptor ditch, a sort of moat around the grave, was being routinely monitored for biosecurity and water quality when a rupture was detected."
"Meaning?"
"The pit's developed a leak."
"Aren't they sealed?"
"They are."
"But it's leaking. I thought these things were impregnable." She shrugged.
"They're supposed to be. Defra used geosynthetic clay liners here, half a meter thick. The pit has sumps and cut-off ditches, boreholes to test the water table."
"But it failed."
"The prevailing theory is that one of the carcasses had rotted down to its skeleton. The weight of the animals above it had gradually forced one of the bigger bones through the clay, a bit like an invasive tree root."
She pointed at a fresh slash in the ground. It was a new burial pit, adjacent to the festering one being exhumed.
"Defra constructed this yesterday. The plan was to exhume the carcasses from the leaking pit and transfer them into this new one. It has a more modern liner. The whole thing was scheduled to take one day."
Poe could see a mound of bones and rotting fleeces at one end. He reckoned they'd transferred about a fifth of the leaking pit's sorry occupants.
"And they found something they weren't expecting."
She nodded.
"The remains of two adult men," she said. "Hogtied with barbed wire, gagged with shorn sheep wool." "Oh my goodness," Bradshaw said.
"That's not the worst of it. They'd been sewn inside the carcasses of cows."
"Blimey," Poe said. "That's new."
"Indeed. Someone had slashed the bellies of two cows, removed the lungs, stomach, intestines, and heart to make room. The men were then put inside. Alive, we think, as their lungs seem full of animal juices, and the cows were stitched closed with baler twine." "Poe," Bradshaw said, "I think I will go back to the car now, if you don't mind."
"I think that's a good idea, Tilly. You don't need to see this."
"I can go and get you something to eat if you want."
"It's okay. I won't be long."
Nightingale looked at him strangely, but said nothing.
"I assume they've been in there since 2001, Poe said.
"Yes. They're just as badly decomposed as the animals. Infected animals were destroyed at their farms of origin. It was sometimes a week before they were collected for burial. We assume whoever's behind this snuck onto an infected farm at night and stitched them inside two of the carcasses. Left them there to be collected by the army. It would explain why they were gagged."
"What a horrific way to die," Poe said.
"Your tone doesn't match your words, Sergeant Poe," Nightingale said. "What do you know that I don't? And why did you tell Tilly you'd be with her soon? I could do with your help on this."
Poe didn't respond.
"Do you want to see them?" she said. "The Home Office pathologist is still in the pit, as we don't know how to recover the bodies intact. I suggested a sieve, and I was only half joking."
"I'm good."
"I think we're going to need a forensic anthropologist to help identify them," she said. "I've not dealt with corpses in this condition before. Not really sure where to start, to be honest."
"Their names are Mark Strawbridge and Vince O'Connell, and they're from Newcastle," Poe said. "If you contact Northumbria Constabulary, they'll give you everything you need. There's an open file on them."
Nightingale's mouth opened in astonishment.
"How the hell?
Do you know what hefting is, ma'am? Poe said.
I've heard the phrase, but I've never bothered to find out what it means.
It's an ancient shepherding technique. If somewhere, the Cumbrian Fells are a great example, has low-quality grass, you need sheep that can roam and forage over large areas to survive. They need far more space than lowland species, which means fencing them in is impractical, isn't cost-effective. So, generations ago, shepherds would persuade their flock to stay on their part of the fell without the need for dry stone walls or fences. They do this by feeding them at dusk in the same place every day. During the day, the sheep wouldn't stray too far. Eventually, the shepherd had no need for food. When the flock's knowledge became intergenerational, they could be considered hefted. They had a loyalty to a particular fell and would always have a loyalty to it.
Okay.
There are farmers out there who are hefted to the land just as much as their livestock is. They'd do anything to protect it. Nightingale looked thoughtful. Were you aware that during the foot and mouth crisis, farmers were compensated, but only if their livestock was slaughtered? Poe continued. Those who suffered as a result of government-ordered restrictions of movement got nothing.
I didn't know that.
Financially speaking, farmers with restriction of movement orders were in a far worse position than those whose animals were being culled. They had no compensation and no way of moving or selling their livestock.
You think this is linked to insurance fraud?
Poe shook his head. I was a beat cop in 2001, he said. And I heard a rumour, less than a rumour really, but it had a strange ring of truth to it. Two men, Geordies, were approaching the farmers of uninfected animals with a way out. They'd got hold of some diseased carcasses, and for a fee, they'd leave one on your land, infect your livestock, make sure you got your compensation, that you wouldn't lose your farm.
You think anyone took them up on their offer?
Do I think there are farmers out there who would have been willing to purposefully infect their animals just to save their livelihood?
She nodded.
Yes, he said. I do think there would have been farmers who'd have at least thought about taking the easy option.
He paused, took in the terrible scene that was unfolding 200 meters away.
And here's what I think happened. I think there's a farmer out there who was approached by these men, listened to them offer to destroy his family's legacy, all for an insurance payout. I think he considered everything and recognized that these men presented a risk, that even if he sent them packing with a load of shotgun pellets up their arse, what's to say his neighbor would do the same? And if a farm is infected, every farm within a 3-mile radius is considered infected.
You think he killed them?
I think he did what no-nonsense farmers do best.
What's that?
Identified the problem and eliminated the problem.
A permanent solution, Nightingale said.
And a deterrent. Nightingale nodded.
How did you find out about this?
My mate's dad was a vet, he said. He told me about a farmer who claimed he'd been offered an infected sheep for £500.
You did some digging?
More to satisfy my own curiosity.
And?
And the rumours had stopped, which meant it had either been a rural myth or...
Or that, Nightingale cut in, pointing at the burial pit.
Or that, Poe agreed. So I contacted Northumbria and asked them to talk me through their missing persons. Strawbridge and O'Connell fitted the bill perfectly. Both men disappeared around the time the rumours stopped. Both had records for rural offences. Theft of livestock and farm equipment. Poaching. Nightingale thought for a few moments.
You were expecting this, weren't you?
Nothing this extreme, he said. But it wouldn't have surprised me if they'd turned up one day in an old septic tank or slurry pit. Farms are second only to abattoirs when it comes to disposing of bodies.
Strawbridge and O'Connell will be on the DNA database, she said. If it's them, we'll have a match in a couple of days. Do you want to be kept informed?
He shook his head. I don't, he said. And I'll tell you two things, ma'am. One, this crime will never be solved. Strawbridge and O'Connell offered this service to the wrong farmer, and they paid the price. He won't have told anyone what he did, and your forensic evidence recovery techniques won't be able to cope with animals that have been decomposing for the last 20 years.
The pathologist has already said as much. No trace evidence whatsoever,
Poe grunted.
You said there were two things, Nightingale said.
I don't give a shit about this, he said quietly. Strawbridge and O'Connell offered an honourable man something dishonourable, and they paid the ultimate price. I'm not saying they got what they deserved, but they did deserve something. I won't be shedding a tear tonight. And with that, he turned and walked away. Bradshaw met him at Penhaligon's car.
Are you okay, Poe?
I am, Tilly, he said. He told her what had happened.
That's horrible, she said.
It is. But come on, it's our week off. Let's get Penhaligon to give us a lift back to mine so we can go to your science place.
Okay, Poe. But we should get your steak and kidney pudding first. They close for lunch soon, and the Sellafield Visitor Centre stays open until 6 o'clock.
Poe turned and looked at the pile of rotting carcasses in the new pit. It was steaming. He tilted his head and squinted. It might have been his imagination, but the pile had a certain pudding shape to it. I've gone off the idea, Tilly, he said. I think I'll have a bacon sandwich instead.
On wholemeal bread?
I've told you, life's too short to not eat white bread. Bradshaw paused, but not for long.
You eat too much meat, Poe.
Why don't sheep shrink? I'm not sure we should trust a thermometer calibrated for a dog's rectum. That's what started it. 13 words. There was a pheasant too, of course. Or maybe it was a peacock. And there was a smell that might have been something in the fridge, but could have been coming from behind the fridge. That was never resolved. But mainly, it was the words. 13 words. 13 unlucky words. Unlucky for Detective Sergeant Washington Poe. Much unluckier for someone else. Day 1. Tilly Bradshaw said Poe's cough was continuous. Poe said it wasn't. Said he'd just eaten a crisp the wrong way.
And there are hardly any cases in Cumbria, he added.
Bradshaw shook her head.
That doesn't matter, Poe, she said. This doesn't spread like the flu. Flu's R0 is about 1.3. That's the mathematical term that indicates how contagious an infectious disease is. But this virus's R0 is 3, and no one has been vaccinated. That means if one person infects 3 people, and those people infect 3 people, and so on, by the end of the 10th day, that first person has indirectly infected 59,000 people. 3 days after that, the number is over 1 million.
You're joking, he said. She wasn't, of course. She rarely made jokes, and when she did, they were never about maths. There was more chance of the Pope saying Jesus' last words on the cross were, I'll be back in 3 days, don't eat my Easter eggs, than Bradshaw making a joke about maths. It would be sacrilegious to her. But I've not left the house in ages.
You were at the pub last night.
Apart from the pub, I've not left the house in ages.
You were at the butcher's on Tuesday.
Okay, yes, and the butcher's.
You were there on Wednesday as well.
I'd forgotten my sausages, but apart from that, I've hardly seen anyone.
I'm here, Poe.
She was. The Serious Crime Analysis Section, SCAS, the National Crime Agency unit that investigated serial killers and apparently motiveless murders, was in the rare position of having no active cases. Poe had accrued a lot of leave. He had said he'd rather be paid for it, but his boss, Detective Inspector Stephanie Flynn, had told him to piss off.
I'm not having you go a whole year without taking leave again, Poe, she had said. That was ridiculous. Tilly needs a break too, and you know she won't take time off unless you do. Take it before the country is locked down.
So here they were. Cumbria in springtime. Glorious weather. Newborn lambs frolicking. Birds nesting. Daffodils everywhere. Bradshaw had taken a room at the nearby Shap Wells Hotel. She had drawn up an itinerary, and then the virus had begun spreading across the country. The places she'd wanted to visit were closing because of the virus, so they needed a rethink, which was what today was about. Or would have been about if Poe hadn't started to cough.
Do you have a temperature, Poe?
He felt his forehead.
No.
I think we should check anyway.
Fine, he said.
I'll go out and get a thermometer tomorrow.
Some battles weren't worth fighting, and it was the responsible thing to do. Bradshaw's R0 numbers were astonishing.
It's okay, Poe. I have one here, she said.
She picked a thermometer off the side of his sofa and leaned over.
Open up.
He did. Bradshaw popped the thermometer in his mouth, and he manoeuvred it under his tongue. He thought that was how you were supposed to do it.
Where you get that from?
He said.
Excuse me?
Poe briefly removed the thermometer.
I said, where did you get that from? I know you come prepared when you visit, but even you wouldn't have brought a thermometer.
It's yours, Poe. I came across it yesterday when I was looking for an apple.
You found it? Here?
Well, I certainly didn't find an apple.
Poe popped it back in his mouth and frowned. He had never owned a thermometer in his life.
Only air you got it from.
What did you say, Poe?
He pulled the thermometer out again.
Show me where you got it from, Tilly.
Bradshaw walked over to a cupboard and retrieved a wooden box. She held it up so he could see.
Oh, you've got to be kidding, he said.
He looked at the thermometer, then flung it away as if it were red hot. It landed on his rug. He ran to the sink and swilled out his mouth, gargled for a full minute.
Whatever's the matter, Poe?
It's Edgar's thermometer, Tilly.
At the mention of his name, the Springer Spaniel opened his eyes and thumped his tail on the floor.
Edgar's?
Bradshaw said.
Yes, Edgar's. The vet wanted me to monitor his temperature after he ate that dead seagull and couldn't stop spewing.
Bradshaw frowned.
But how does Edgar know to keep it in his mouth?
It's a rectal thermometer, Tilly. It goes up his bum.
He looked at the thin glass tube on his rug. It was glistening with his saliva.
And I've just had it in my bloody mouth.
Bradshaw looked at it.
Oh,
she said. She picked it up, scanned the reading, then glanced at him.
What? He said.
You have a temperature, Poe.
Anyway, so that's how I ended up with a mouthful of dog shit, Poe said to the laptop.
Flynn's face filled the screen. Poe's was in a small box in the top corner. He hated video conference calls. He didn't see why it was necessary to see the person with whom you were on the phone. He certainly didn't know why he had to be on the screen as well. He suspected it was the latest desire of the egomaniac to look at yourself while you were speaking.
Tilly says you need to self-isolate, Flynn said.
Poe could tell she was trying hard not to laugh.
Tilly's not a doctor, he said.
Yes, I am,
Bradshaw chipped in.
Not a real doctor.
She was polishing Edgar's thermometer. She held it up so Poe could see how clean it was. He glared at her.
Okay, what did the medical doctor say?
Flynn said.
That I was fine.
Tilly, what did the doctor say? That Poe has to self-isolate for 7 days.
Anything else?
Yes. When she asked Poe if anything else was bothering him, he said, why don't sheep shrink when it rains?
Flynn didn't immediately respond.
I find it oddly comforting that you're a dickhead to everyone, Poe, she said eventually.
All I'm saying is, I'm not sure we should trust a thermometer calibrated for a dog's rectum, he said.
Tilly tells me you also have a cough.
Poe said nothing. He didn't feel ill, but Bradshaw's number of 59,000 was rattling around his head.
Poe?
Fine, he sighed. I'll stay here for 7 days, not a moment longer, though.
I really don't know what you're complaining about, Poe, Flynn said. You and Edgar, all on your own on that fell of yours. A government instruction not to interact with anyone. Isn't that your idea of nirvana?
Bradshaw cleared her throat. She looked uneasy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.